Welcome back, guys! So we're starting into qualifier number 5. Very small break indeed, and it instantly starts when we come back. With me will be Killer B. So, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, for the King of the Hippo qualifier number 5. We are in Relic Heaven. That's a map where we have 2 scouts, 1 monk, and a normal Dark Age start, very few gold spots, and a lot of gold. Oh god, this hippo. A lot of relics in the middle to grab. So, let's see how the players will go. I gave them the choice to decide between Saracens and Mongols. Tattoo and Eddie actually went for Saracens, the rest went for Mongols. So let's see how they will do about that. And there will be so much action. Welcome, Killer B.
Yo, I'm here. How's it going?
I'm doing great. I'm very exhausted. We just had like 2 hours 15 minutes game on Ghost Lake before in qualifier number 4, and now we are Olaf might lose his monk instantly. Let's see if he is able to convert or his monk is instantly down, so that's no relics for him for now. You need to mute your microphone while typing, please. And Tato is now getting the first relic, so is Spring. The rest now trying to slowly crawl into it. And Olaf now in the possibly worst situation you could ever be in. So, how do you like the map, Killer B?
I'm actually just catching up to you. I'm trying to figure out which lobby you're in and get in the game with you. Sorry.
Okay, we're in Medieval Siege game number 1. And convert. Let's see if the 3 scouts can save Tato scout. No, they can't. So Tato now has 3 scouts, but no monk left, so no relics for him either. So for now it's Spring, the only one catching 1 relic, and so is Tetra Pak here. Oh, he already has one in the bank. That is sick run for him indeed. Let's see, Jon Snow now getting Witch's Arrow, getting his relic as well. And yeah, there's just so much action starting from the first second. I think Milo was in quite unfortunate position where his monastery is and where he did start. But yeah, if you lose your monk early, it doesn't really matter how you started.
So yeah, I'm here with you, man. I'm just looking at the map. This is going to be one chaotic game. Hopefully you have a little bit of energy left from last game.
Yeah, I have.
I saw just the end of it, and it was pretty epic of a game. Obviously, tons of relics in the middle here are going to be important. We saw everybody really run out of gold last game. We also saw a lot of people running out of everything, like wood, the natural resources that you really need. A little bit more wood on this map, maybe? Question mark?
Yeah, I think so. Some smaller pieces, but just a fight for the relics in the middle will be so crucial. And let's see now. It seems like Jon Snow will most likely lose his monk here and his hopes to get more relics in the early age. So, Olaf now going back. And it seems like Tetra Pak might be getting his 3rd relic here. How is that even possible? And nobody lost his... Did he lose his monk close to his town center? It just looks like it. Okay, so very, very scrappy game. Tough to catch all the action. Spring is actually doing a great job. I think this might be his 3rd relic already. And 3rd relic for Grey indeed, yeah. And then you run out of gold pretty darn quickly. Okay, just tell me the decision, Mongols or Saracens?
In this game, I don't even know, because people are going to be turtling up here, and this is going to go long term. If you look at somebody like Eddie right now as Saracens, he's all turtled up. He's starting to wall up already, starting to palisade himself in. I don't know. I don't know enough about the strategy of this one, but I'm ready to see this one go down. It's pretty interesting. I mean, do you want to play this for the self-preservation game where you're going to have an army to win this an hour and a half in? Or is that something we haven't seen a lot of?
Yeah, we have seen a lot of like camping strategies for sure, but Eddie actually is in the worst positioning to camping because he did not fight for the relics at all.
Yeah,
although he had a good monastery placement there, and I think camping for him isn't the greatest option because yeah, he will just struggle.
It's very interesting too because those palisades are very tight around his area. He's really like walling himself into a very small spot. Definitely getting out early and getting those relics seems like the better strategy, but we'll see how it works out. Just looking around the map, I see Spring has two already. Everybody's still active in the middle with their monks. Spring grabbing another relic now. Purple player using his scouts to protect that monk, which seems like a wise move. Other people are just going...
Yellow and green trying to prevent that, yeah. But nice try to protect the monk for sure. Might get some damage done on the scouts now, but yeah, no chance of saving him.
Yeah, he's in some trouble. It's happening very slowly. That monk is going to die, though. It looks like that monk's going to go down. You can see that Spring's monk is also getting picked down by the teal player, Tato. So the monks are now dead. The people who were able to get out and get a few early relics are going to have a big bonus, but everybody has what they have now, I think. I don't think there's a monk left that I can see in the middle.
I think Eddie has one in his base left, mm-hmm. And yellow lost is pretty early, so the teal. So I think we might be down to a single monk for Eddie there, yeah? Just maybe he wants to go for... like 5 pikemen now and get all the relics in the middle.
That
would be a sick strategy, but not really sure. Even like all the players only have one mission now to kill the single left monk, so they would easily lose all their 8 scouts which are still left. so funny, this monument, to just kill the single monk. It would be absolutely worth it.
Yeah, it would be, but I mean, if he can wait until, you know, somebody at some point is going to get aggressive and start trying to pick on villagers, maybe like Milo right now is moving in, maybe just doing some scouting, but somebody's going to get aggressive with those scouts, and eventually, I mean, if we talk about waiting maybe 15 more minutes, you could conceive somebody sneaking in there with their monk. We'll see how it goes.
Well, in 15 minutes, players will reach castle age, obviously, and then they can produce more monks,
mm-hmm.
So... oh, look at the gold of Spring already, 500 gold, and now he's adding more scouts. That's a weird decision. Seems like he wants to play it more of the 1v1 style compared to most approaches of the others who are trying to play it a bit slower.
Lots of big names in this game. Lots of people I'm noticing as good players. I just don't know who's best suited for this particular style of map.
Yeah, that's so true. Like, I think players like Eddie should be super experienced and thinking about this a lot. I think Tato obviously did show how great he is. He won a qualifier very convincingly, did play great in the last finals as well. And I think Jon Snow, which is Arrow and a very experienced, like, Monk Rusher arena player, should have clearly the brains. I think Milo has great skills, but I don't really see him at this. And I think like Spring generally is like one of the guys with the greatest micro, greatest knowledge about the game. He still manages to screw up every team game. So yeah, total, like, huge respect for a lot of achievements he had. For example, his great 1v1 deathmatch skill he accomplished now. But still, his, like, random map rating in team games, like, after 500 games, still, like, 1550. And at the same time, was 2050 in 1v1 Hans War. It's so weird, this guy.
What's interesting is you just saw Tetra and Gray get up to castle. 3 relics in the monastery, ready to go. Building up has not really been bothered too much, so that's going to be the earliest castle age time, at least from what I can see. We'll see if we can do something with it. Looks like for now it's just building up that economy. Have not seen a second TC. There it is. Second TC coming down. So he's going to build up an eco and try to take things over. Walling off across the front with those palisades. Just some wimpy palisades to keep the scout aggression out. But the gray player here looks in good shape. Certainly has the best castle time by a good margin. Jon Snow will be not too far behind. Eddie, Mio, everybody else is really clicked up by now. But yeah, we could see the gray player potentially do something early and aggressive. We will see.
Especially because he's building a second monastery and has already some relic gold, obviously. So his monk production should be pretty great. And if he can snag like 4 or 5 more relics, he should be in the possibly prime position. Because most players will kind of have to rely on building a lot of hussars later on. And he can add some mangodoys.
I like this a lot. His forward-ish monastery. He can grab those relics and get back home pretty quickly. He should be able to get a couple, like you said. He's got 3 or 4, maybe even 5 there that are within striking distance, and nobody's really around to stop him right now.
Oh, Olaf has a hole, and he didn't see it. He will lose some villagers, most likely. Let's see how quick the walls in the north are. What is Spring doing? He could easily have gotten in there, and now he's getting in. We'll get at least one villager, maybe more. Oh, misclicking on the lumber camp there. And yeah, Olaf lost one villager there. So it's all still in a reasonable range. Tetrapak getting more and more monks out here.
Still keeping an eye on the gray player here. Yeah, just moving those monks out. I wonder if he will eventually shuffle those relics from that forward monastery back into his more safe one in the center of his base. But we'll keep an eye on him.
I would absolutely love to see that for sure, because so much aggression will be in the middle. Orange will be attacking. As you can see, nobody 41, I think he will cast the next game with us, is actually attacking with hell of a lot of spearmen there. But Tetrapak is converting and has already got one. Now second spearman. Oh no, it's still one.
Yeah, so nobody and Tetra here are really having a war between themselves for the moment. You can see that nobody knows he needs to stop his opponent from gathering all those relics, so he's really doing a lot of work to do so. But in the meantime, the person on the other side of nobody, Eddie, has 3 monks coming in who are going to snag relics because there's no one at home to protect right now.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a little bit of a tough game right now for nobody. He's really trying to defend. He's trying to help everyone else win, but he's not really helping himself win that much.
Yeah, he has one monk and has one relic secured at his home base. But yeah, not really seeing how he's getting into much more. What is Olaf doing there with his TC in nowhere?
Yeah, Olaf getting aggressive with that TC in the front, monastery right behind it. So he is going to be focused on relics as well. Everybody's thinking about relics right now. Everybody except for Spring. Spring right now is kind of roaming around the map, still trying to do some damage, I suppose.
What is he doing? 4 archery ranges? Still has one relic close by. That's weird. Tattoos start pretty screwed there. Nobody is getting a second relic now. And Olaf, he has 4 relics. Let's see, how many does he have at home? He didn't get any at home, so that's why he built this. But I think, like, this town center will never live. I think he should, just maneuver all his relics back at home and give up this TC there.
Yeah, I agree. I think that's got to be part of his strategy. Obviously, you can't just plop down a TC in the middle of the map and hope for it to live. But I feel like just looking at this, I think Eddie's done pretty well. He hasn't taken any fights. He's coming forward with lots of monks. He's grabbing relics. Right now he's on 3, but he could conceivably grab a few more without too much of a fight. I mean, Tetra, for instance, has been really having to fight his way to get all of the relics that he has. Eddie's kind of just using the sneak tactic. Meanwhile, Tato with 0 relics is on stone with 4 villagers, has a second TC and maybe even a third up here back at home. Yes, he does. 4 TCs up. So Tato booming up. Those archers just now coming in from Spring. I don't know if you're seeing that, but he's ready to do some raiding with Cav archers on Tato.
Yeah, I can see that, and obviously Coverage is a great unit to raid, but Spring is slowing himself down there so much, and I think that's pretty unnecessary because it's not really giving him the option to actually kill Tato. So I think it's just slowing both players down and just decreasing their chances to win the middle there.
Olaf right now with 8 relics. We'll see if that lasts. I mean, getting them all the way back home is still going to be a huge challenge. All 8 of them are going to be inside that one forward monastery, at least from what I can see.
Soon to be 9 even, but yeah, he needs to get them home.
Got to get them safe. Meanwhile, it's just beautiful. Eddie's roaming around with sets of 2 or 3 monks roaming together to try to... actually, now he's headed towards Spring to maybe convert some villagers and do some annoyance on Spring. Yeah, Spring's still raiding Tato, which is fine. He wants to keep maybe the top player in the game, Tato, here a little bit down. But I don't know. Like you said, that use of resources seems like a bit of a waste because those gold units are going to be... The gold from those relics is going to be incredibly important here in the late game. Still watching Tato on stone. 4 villagers on stone over there. Let's look around the horn. Looks like he's just using that to build more TCs. Not really saving up a whole bunch, neither is anybody else.
Yeah, obviously booming is now his main goal. I think Olaf is doing just poor strategic decisions there. Like, this forward monastery was pretty nice, adding pikemen there as well, but how will he ever expect to hold this position there? Everyone will fight, like, not even the whole screen away from this area. And there are like 3-4 players coming from this area even. So there's just no chance he can ever keep this relics. And then we will have like a second wave of people trying to fight for relics again.
Yeah, and just as a side note, Eddie came in with several monks, a couple of scouts, and some villagers, tried to drop a TC on Spring's top gold pile, that one big gold pile near Spring. Spring was able to push him back with those Cav Archers, so those Cav Archers turned out to be a fantastic investment. Killed a good half dozen monks and several scouts and denied that TC. That would have been horrible for Spring to have to live without that gold.
Yeah, for sure. I think he didn't have any other gold income, obviously, except his monasteries. By the way, he had a relic pretty close by in front of his starting houses, and it feels like Eddie did snag this one, right? Because Spring doesn't have a monk.
Right now, I have Spring on 3 relics with this dashboard, but I don't know if he got the particular one that you're thinking of. He has 1 monk in the back. Eddie just lost a whole pile of them. Unfortunately, he is going to be playing on he's going to have to live with the relics he has for the moment, building up some siege as well, so we'll keep an eye on him. Did you see the forward castle here from Jon Snow? Not too far forward, but forward enough to protect both of the gold piles here in the front of Jon Snow's area. Seems like a good tactical decision. And meanwhile, I've been noticing Milo, I don't know how you say that name, building out stone walls on his side and really taking over a lot of territory. Has more territory right now than anybody else.
Yeah, but without really resources there, he's not protecting any gold or stone. Only 1 small stone, but behind his TC even, so he's not really saving up any gold spot. He doesn't even have any gold spot except 1 small pile in the front there. So, yeah, feels like more like a early warning system than actually protection of his corner.
Yeah, right now that monument ticking down. We are at 230 years. Obviously not going to be won here in the first initial push, but you never know. Olaf right now does control the middle. There's a lot of infighting between players in the top corner of the map, between Eddie and Spring and Tato. They've been kind of battling each other. Can't lose focus on the important thing of this game, which is that center of the map.
Yeah, and Olaf is already showing us that he is not thinking about getting those relics away, trying to wall his monastery there, and I think that's a poor decision, but we did mention that often enough. So Let's think about who is the most likely guy to get those 9 precious relics out of Olaf.
Well, Jon Snow just hitting Imperial. We also have Eddie on his way up. Milo is also in Imperial now. So those players can make a bit of a push. Not sure about military counts. At the moment, it does not seem like anybody has a large military. Spring has 22. You know, Tetra has a bit of a formidable army on his side. A couple of knights, a couple of light cav out on the field, but is not yet up to the Imperial Age. So I don't know who's going to crack open that that nest there of relics and take those all home. More castles, though, coming from Olaf. Olaf is making a push to try to win this game right here, right now. Seems to be very aggressive. That's way too early.
Yeah, that's very aggressive, but too early. Players can easily swipe him off. If it's Eddie or is it Jon Snow, Milo could easily do it, and Tato. So, like, 4 players who are so far ahead when it comes to boom, when it comes to positioning. So, and if they team up, there's just no chance. He will lose all his castles, all his relics, so many villagers, and all his advantages he could have saved.
Just looking around the horn, it does look like there's still a lot of infighting here between Eddie and Spring. Spring's whole army is sort of waiting for the next potential push from Eddie. Eddie's got those Mamelukes out on the field. And for now, it's a bit of a... Those guys are distracted with each other. You can see the gray player here, Tetra, is moving up to the north toward Nobody. Nobody right now is actually in a lot of trouble. Battering rams inside of his base. He's actually getting gutted out pretty severely at the moment. That is going to be Olaf, because everybody's focusing on each other. We can also see the purple player here, Milo in the middle, has those Mangadai out. Seems to be maybe trying to hit Olaf back at home, maybe cutting him off from his initial base. We'll see what Milo does here. We'll see what Tato does. Both players have been quiet. But for now, man, that raiding inside of Nobody's base is going to be a huge problem for him.
Yeah, especially the sneaky rams from the right-hand side, he absolutely did not see that coming. And this might be like 2 extra relics now for Tetra, because he already has 6 and can easily get those 2 pretty uncontested now. And I think, like, Nobody could actually resign before really reaching Imperial Age here.
Yeah, it's a very difficult game. You have to sort of take a risk, and in this case, Nobody seemed to be building up for a potential push with an army on his side, in the middle maybe, and then this sneak attack from sort of out of nowhere from Tetra comes in and really, really guts him out. Hopefully we'll see Nobody continue to fight his way through, but is going to have an incredible amount of trouble trying to get back in this. May have no chance to get back in it, but...
Yeah, even on the side, like, obviously there are so fewer resources splitting around with villagers, and still has, I believe, let's see, his pop 11 villagers, 4 military, so really running around at weird spaces. Now even reaching in between Tato and Spring, so that's a weird migration for sure. At the same time, we have Eddie and Spring heavily going at each other, but... Yeah, it's still, I think it's Imperial Army against Castle Age Army. Obviously, Eddie does not have all the upgrades, but Spring can't really advance here.
Yeah, right now, Olaf's still holding the middle. There's no army really whatsoever there in the middle. Brought all of his army back, Mangadai mostly, to try to protect his own zone. You can see that Milo is pushing in there with 4 Trebs, several Mangadai right now, but those are maybe going to get cleaned up and pushed back by the army of the yellow player. Nobody's still in a whole world of hurt right now, really in a lot of trouble. It doesn't actually look like the gray player is interested in killing any more of Nobody's buildings. He's leaving the center. Unfortunately, he's doing it very slowly along with that ram. Grabbing those relics like you said he would, and maybe heading toward the middle. Somebody needs to deal with the middle right now. These players are... It's obvious that that shouldn't work in the middle, but if they're all fighting each other, that's going to be a problem. Somebody's got to go and deal with the middle here.
Yeah, absolutely, and I think the push from Milo against Olaf was kind of a try there, but... Yeah, Milo should be out of gold pretty soon, so he will be only Hussars. I think he only has 1 relic, now completely has like 600 gold left to mine. And... Let's see, sneaky GC by nobody there behind the base of Tetra Pak. Funny move.
You know, it's interesting. Jon Snow just now knocking down the monastery from... Oh. Yeah, knocking down the monastery here from Tetra and stealing those three relics on the front.
Yeah, good job there. And you're winning two from nobody and losing two against Jon Snow, maybe even three pretty soon. So yeah, as we said before, really moving your relics back to safer lines would have helped out so much more for Tetra Pak now and probably Olaf pretty soon. Although Olaf has a scary army there in the middle. But yeah, once people will be pushing against him, he will lose so many food eco even. Which is pretty unimportant, but yeah.
Yeah, Olaf trying to build out some houses to get a little bit of an alarm system going so he can see armies that are coming in. He's going to find out that Eddie is coming in with a few mams right now. Should be able to deal with that, but he is going to lose a few vils. It's going to slow him down a bit here. And yeah, for the moment, we continue to push our way through this one. Olaf trying to make the early play, but Tato trying to really... I think Tato may have the best economy here, really waiting for the later game. 151 vils, really piling up a lot of resources. The thing that... the gamble that some of these players are taking is they're all fighting each other, trying to expand their own ecos, but somebody has to go and deal with the middle. It's going to happen soon. I'll stop worrying about it. It's going to happen soon. TC...
Well, and Tato now going heavily into spring space, killing all the army, sniping those three relics. Now should get up to four relics, I believe. Will snipe all the castles, and I think spring, will just die in the sandwich of the both Saracens there.
Yeah, Tato stealing those three relics from spring. That might be the most important part of this whole fight. He's going to sneak out the back door with those. Eddie's going to do a lot of work on the front. He's going to certainly neutralize spring, but he's not going to get what he really would want out of this, which would be those sweet, sweet relics.
Yeah, so we're down to 80 years now. So all the time we are saying, okay, Olaf isn't playing this clever, he's doing this and that wrong. But actually, if no one is attacking him soon, he might take this.
There is enough chaos on this map for him to win just based on nobody's challenged him in the middle yet. There's been no actual army sent. We've seen six mams from Eddie who ran in and noticed that, oh, we can't get the job done and left. So Eddie knows what's up in the center. He knows what he needs to do. But yeah, right now so much infighting between everybody else.
And he has a reasonable army as well. Like one player is coming, they need to send mass rams or... Onidris there as well to clear him up.
Yeah, we're seeing Tato now actually making a pretty big push from the backside of this area. He's going to knock down that monastery right away and probably start grabbing those relics pretty aggressively here soon. Quite a lot of elite mams. That is going to be an army that the yellow player Olaf can definitely not deal with in the long term. 61 years, I believe it's 4 seconds per year, so I think that's 4 minutes. He's going to have to hold this for 4 minutes. Which seems unlikely even just from Tato's army. And in the meantime, we'll see Jon Snow coming from the other side with a couple of siege rams and several Mangadai there. So yeah, this is not going to work in the middle for Olaf. We had a chance to dream about it, but it doesn't look good, does it?
Yeah, huge armies there. Milo now has Siege Onager upgrade as well. Now Olaf trying to save a relic there, but... yeah, it will be tough for him. So many armies surrounding him and so many players already glimpsing at, oh, look at those 9 juicy relics here.
Yeah, he wasn't able to sneak any of those back home. He kept them all in that front area. I didn't see him even try to sneak any back home. Just went for it all out, all in the early game. Maybe that's the right play with so many elite top players in this game to maybe just go for the win right away. But it does not look like it's going to pay off here. Has how many years left? 100 years still. Those rams are right on the front door, so this is not going to happen. In the meantime, we see nobody has just that one little snuck TC really completely gutted. Spring is still being gutted on his side by Eddie. Eddie is continuing to put the pressure on with a small army, just big enough to really knock Spring completely out of this game. In the meantime, Tato's still building up, still taking a lot of stone. He was actually mining Spring stone for quite some time there. Allowed him to build some forward castles. castles, some forward-ish castles, and that's going to put Tato in a good position to win this game in the long term.
Yeah, right. Olaf was down to 40 years, but then got intercepted by Jon Snow, who is now killing a lot of traps there off Tato, and it killed all the monks who were trying to snipe this off, so not really sure what Tato is actually doing. Is he going home to defend? Because he could have taken better fights there. Now a lot of monks of Milo coming in, so really a lot of players trying to get there. As you can see, Jon Snow is sending the monks, and Tato was before.
Yeah, it's interesting when you send your army forward to take down that central aggression, you can sometimes get caught out. I don't know what happened to Tato's trebs, but I presume he must have kept them up. But those he lost all of those trebs in the middle. That's what can happen sometimes. You extend yourself out, and there's a bunch of Mangadai from your opponent that you weren't anticipating to fight, and then you get cleaned up. We see that Olaf has lost the middle. He's moved a bit toward where nobody started the game and has built three TCs, but another player that's, for all intents and purposes, I shouldn't say knocked out. He still has an economy back home. He's not truly being raided there just yet, but we should not see a lot from Olaf for quite some time. So Olaf, Nobody, and Spring seem to be in a lot of trouble. We haven't heard anything from the purple player Mio, really. So Milo should be able to maybe come forward, has Siege Onager. We'll see what he does, grabbing some of those central relics. Those relics are still mostly hanging out in the middle, but Milo is able to snipe one of them. And this game is actually, it started off very chaotic. It's actually getting a lot simpler right now. We have really five players who are left to vie for the win here. And we'll see who can get the job done.
Yeah, Milo actually is sniping four of the relics, so that's a big win for him. He was struggling heavily before on gold, now losing a lot of his Mangadai trapped there in between Tato's army, so that's still a big loss for him, although he is now slowly getting into the game where he can actually win, because I was fearing he was booming all the time, but just couldn't get the gold income gun going. So, and now you say Olaf is having some army, but actually, he has no chance of ever getting onto gold units ever again.
Yeah, so right now in the middle is the gray player Tetra. Tetra has been a bit quiet here as of recent, is not going to be able to hold it. There's really no chance of that because Tato is on one side very close, Jon Snow is on the other. Both of those players, as well as Tetra, are really, I should say, both of those players are building toward the center. They're going to be able to reinforce the center very quickly. You can see Jon Snow's stables are terribly close there, and so are the stables from Tato. So those players seem to be positioned to maybe give this one a push, but they're going to have to fight each other first, I would suppose.
Yeah, it will be like a lot of running around, and I think we can't really see any clear engagements unless people are going for the Siege Onager attack there. Because that's the only chance to really take significant winning fights there, I'd have to say.
Yeah, I agree with you. We'll see how this one goes. Meanwhile, still watching Spring get gutted out, still watching Tato just happily booming up his eco back at home, just happily unbothered at the moment. He's got a dead player to his right, a dead-ish player, Olaf. He's got a dead player to his left in Spring. So I really like the position here of Tato. Eddie on the other side has a similar advantage. Players on both sides of him are really dead, so he's not getting raided by his nearest neighbor. We may see that happen between Jon Snow and Milo, but right now it is a fight for the center.
Yeah, indeed, and all the players are kind of not thinking about the fort able to grab relics anymore, except Milo, who is sending more and more monks in now, and is trying to protect the relics, but now Tato is trying to get them as well, trying to build a new monastery, and I think those two players will now, yeah, fight for it.
Yeah, there's three or four relics there in the middle that are still have still not been grabbed. Spring typing in GG. Spring's gonna call it a day. Can't blame him. He really got sandwiched by two top players, got really gutted out, had all of his resources really chewed up in fighting his nearest opponents, and he has no play for the center. See, Onager's in the center from the gray player, who is still there and still alive, keeps getting intercepted, but is still putting what he has into maybe the second big push for the middle. You would think Tato or Jon Snow could crush that at any time, but right now he's going to hold the center. Jon Snow really building up a lot of Mangadai. He's going to have a lot of Mangadai and Hazar, as well as a couple of Trebs on his side. And on Tato's side, we're just seeing Elite Mams, we're seeing Hazars, and we're seeing him mostly fighting Mio right now. Those two players seem to have a little bit of aggression toward each other.
Yeah, you say that Jon Snow can easily take the middle, but actually without Oningers against Oningers, that can't be a good fight at all. So you have to split so much, have to invest so many Hussars before sniping the Oningers, then you have to fight against Rams as well. So I think Tetra Pak, although he's still missing an upgrade, and two upgrades even, would have the upper hand in the fight.
Interesting that Jon Snow is saying, let's kill Tato. He stole all the relics. Jon Snow on 6, Tato on 6, but he's still trying to incite some anger toward Tato. Maybe he can snipe and win the center if somebody else is focusing on killing Tato. But yeah, that fight in the middle is going down. Like you said, the gray player with those siege onagers, or those onagers, is going to be in a decent spot. Has some siege rams there as well. Jon Snow not ready to take that fight. Just 60 years left, but should be quite some time. Go ahead, Nilly. Sorry.
Yeah, 60 years are a lot. No, I was laughing because Jon Snow. No, I did offer Jon Snow to trade, but that obviously would have been through like 50 Mangadais and 10 Onagers, so not really a chance there. And we're down to 50 years, and there's still a very healthy army from Tetra Pak here.
Anything can happen. We saw that in the last game. I don't want to give any spoilers, but holy cow, that came down to the very last second. This could happen if you send your villagers forward, if you do something crazy here. If you're the gray player, you may just snipe a win, but it does look like he's idling a ton of villagers back at home, really focusing on microing that center. We'll see if he can hold it.
Yeah, he would have been better off to send all those villagers in the middle now. Let's see, Jon Snow is attacking. The Onager shots have to be big. Let's see, he's trying to regroup. Maybe even attacking the Hussars could be an option now, because the Mangadais are so far behind. Jon Snow is taking a good fight. Some shots there, but still too few Onagers. I think he only has 5 Onagers, and now Tato's coming from the top. Maybe trying to snipe those Onagers. So nice team play again, that trying to regroup Tetra Pak, that is. Now the Onagers are in front, and now he's only fighting with some Mangadais. I can't do much in the middle, Tato says, but actually Jon Snow is doing great. We're down to 30 years. There's still a lot of Mangadais in the middle from Tetra Pak there, but I think he might be pushed off.
This is when the chaos begins. You can see that Mila has sent a small army. Jon Snow has a big army. Tato is coming in from the top. As long as those guys aren't fighting each other, as long as they're microing well and taking on Tetra, they should be just fine. So big fight going on here. It does not look like Tetra will hold it, but 25 years is not a horribly long time.
Yeah, it is not, but still he has half of the amount of Mangadais from Jon Snow there. He is microing them a bit better, but now Onagers are coming. Let's see if he can see them. Yeah, he has the overview and thinks better of it. It's retreating, and the middle is Jon Snow's now.
Close, but no cigar, as they say. The green player, Jon Snow, for the moment will hold the center, but he doesn't really have the army there to hold it for long. It doesn't look like he actually wants it. He's going to retreat away from that right away and save his resources. Heading back right now, it does not look like that aggression from Eddie did too much to Tato. It did knock 4 relics out of his, by the looks of it, out of his monastery, and actually Eddie is relatively close. He may steal some relics here from Tato.
Oh yeah, that makes sense now. I was just looking at the stats there, and Tato's still missing the last attack upgrade for both his Mamelukes and his Hussar there. And yeah, Eddie pushing for the middle. He says he can't win the middle. He's not pushing for the middle, he's pushing for Tato, because he said I can't win the middle, saving a lot of gold, Eddie that is, and having a lot of wood and food as well. So yeah, let's see. Tato is now trying to get his relics back. Still has some in the front there. And Jon Snow still has a very deadly army there.
Yes, yeah, still a little bit of aggression from Eddie. We see Tato able to grab some of his own relics back at home. Everyone has pretty much abandoned the center. We do still have Tetra with some buildings that are awfully close, but for all intents and purposes, Tetra for now is abandoned the center. His rally points are back at home as far as what I can tell, so he's not trying to take over the middle, of course. Nobody is still alive in the back of the gray player's base, but he has been discovered there, and we can see Hazar's rolling in now, so nobody continuing to be kicked while he's down. Spring has resigned. Olaf is, for all intents and purposes, still dead. And we'll see what Eddie can do versus Tato. It's a decent strategy, in my opinion. If there's the fewer players that are in the game, the better chance you have of winning the middle. But we'll see. Eddie may, in the end, undermine his own desires. He might let somebody like Jon Snow win the center while he's busy trying to kill Tato. But we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, at the moment, Jon Snow is even clearing up Chateau even further and further. I'm quite surprised by that. But Eddie is just building such a weak army so that he can't really push. He only was pushing due to Chateau heavily focusing on the middle to get Olaf off there. So, yeah, I think the moment Chateau refocuses on Eddie, I think he should easily push him back.
Yeah, right now, Milo has the most relics. I have him at seven relics in the monastery. Is really quiet, very quiet for long periods in this game. Now he's sending small armies forward, not really wanting to take a fight. Seems to be playing this rather wisely, being a bit cautious. We'll see if that pays off for the purple player. Like you said, that push on the front doesn't have a lot of teeth to it. Eddie's really just clinging to a castle there and maybe trying to steal those relics eventually. But for right now, we have a bit of a stalemate. Nobody's actually trying to win the center. Milo has a small amount of Hazars there, but that is it for the moment.
Yeah, Jon Snow was heavily fighting against Milo. We did see that great micro there, but Jon Snow sniping those onages pretty nicely. Mm-hmm. And yeah, kind of keeping everyone down there. Not really sure. Tetra Pak has been quiet now as well. He should have like four relics as well, so quite a reasonable income.
All right, I've got a bit of a pause, but I think we're back to it.
Oh, I'm at 1610.
Gotcha.
Okay, so the two only Saracens going at each other, not trying to play with the Mongols here. Staying back, and yeah, it seems like Tato indeed is winning those fights there. Hassas and Eddie is only going for skirmishes. Not really sure what his plan is there. His resources just dropped heavily. Not really sure if he's producing something. Not really. Nobody is like a parasite. Let's see. Yeah, some villages over here, some over here. Yeah, he is still keeping his pop. Oh, building another TC over here. Yeah, he's back to 13 villagers.
Hopefully a symbiotic organism there. Nobody is not going to chew up Tetra's chance to win, but Tetra's in a lot of trouble after that initial push. Eddie still focusing fully on Tato. This could be a good time for Jon Snow or Mio to make a move, but the thing that strikes me here is that Jon Snow is in kind of a very tight area. Running out of wood in some spots of his base, does not have a lot of territory on the map. Milo walled up pretty early, and right now there is an opening into Jon Snow's base. If Milo and Jon Snow want to fight each other, they can do that right here, right now. But for now, the middle is still contested. Lots of elite Mangadai there from Tetra, actually, coming out of nowhere. Didn't see that army coming. Tetra's going to have a small army there for a moment, certainly going to chew up some damage on his opponents. Meanwhile, Jon Snow is on the other side of Milo, getting some damage in. So Milo right now taking a pretty bad fight on all sides, unfortunately.
Yeah, I think so as well. Not having all the upgrades, his onage is pretty much exposed. And he can't really get up to his, like, the really clumped elite Mangudai flock you want to have, like, 40 to 60 Mangudais there, like the beautiful Jon Snow here can show us. And yeah, Jon Snow is just staying back, wants to wait till all the others are wasting their gold resources. Did sell a lot of wood and food now. Let me take a look. What did he invest it on? Only mango dice, okay, so he wants to go for like 120 mango dice and then maybe take the middle. And yeah, I was wrong on the other side with Chateau against Eddie. Eddie really pushing there and getting the relics from Chateau, so Chateau might be down to very few relics. Let's take a look there. It is 4 relics only. So yeah, that's obviously way less than his maximum amount he had from like 9 or something. And really struggling because Eddie's skirmisher push actually seems to be effective, which is quite surprising to me.
Just looking around the map, looking around the horn at players' resources, Milo right now has 26k wood and 10k food, and he is blowing everyone else away in those two categories. Also has 7 of the relics, at least last time I checked. So maybe the purple player here being patient and really going to fight this one in the long term. We know that wood can run out in these games. Having a huge stockpile of wood may actually benefit him in the long run. So we'll see what Milo can do with that. I keep screwing up Milo's name, but I'll get it right.
Yeah, no worries. I think pronouncing names correctly is one of the toughest things as a caster, especially when you have players all around the world. Once we try to cast a game from like China C, and you have never heard the games before, and there were so many X's, Y's and Q's, so it was like that. Okay, I'd pronounce him Chao Ching, and Memp was like, oh, I would pronounce him like Chao Qiong, and Katsuni was like, eh? Isn't his name like Dori Gangyoga? And yeah, so it's ridiculous sometimes. By the way, we kind of over chatted a bit that Tetra Pak is having a nice push here, building a lot of walls, and we're down to 40 years. And Milo is now pretty much in the middle. Jon Snow obviously very aware at all times, but still without a lot of siege.
Yeah, Jon Snow with a massive army right now needs to start pushing in. Looks like he's going to take it on from the side that is partially walled. Fortified walls are up, but they're not going to get the job done for long. There are certainly too many holes there, and yeah, I think this isn't going to work once again for Tetra, but making another nice little play for it. At least somebody is aggressive in the middle, and it seems to be Tetra so far. And has done a good job to be aggressive without being desperate. Unfortunately, Olaf went all in and got crushed, but Tetra is still somewhat alive. So we could see Tetra continue to fight, even though he's going to lose the middle here. The thing to watch, though, is Jon Snow's army there in the middle actually could hold it. I mean, the other armies on the map right now are really just Milo, who does not have enough to push him back. Eddie is still busy fighting Tato, seems to just have a penchant for killing Tato. Go ahead.
Yeah, it's just so funny. Like, it looks a bit like a Castle Blood scenario or something. The amount of only elite Mango Dai is there, and even Milo had to laugh there. By the way, you said Tetra Pak is like not overextending, but his pushes are getting weaker and weaker every time because he's still losing costly gold units. It's Eddie against Chateau all the time. So I think Jon Snow is looking pretty good here to have a strong push, especially if Milo and Tetra Pak aren't teaming up and trying to crush his army in the middle.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting. We're going to have to see. I mean, Eddie has not blinked whatsoever. He hasn't moved any armies toward the middle at all. He's been fighting and killing the players adjacent to him, and that is it. So we can't expect Eddie to lend any army to the middle to crush Jon Snow. That has not been part of his repertoire thus far. We'll have to see either Milo do the job or potentially with a little bit of help from Tetra, but neither of those guys with an army by themselves that can crush that central aggression. Here we go, though. Looks like the purple player is coming in. This is about to go down. Sending in his units. He needs to retreat back.
Oh, and Tetra Pak is doing a huge mistake, going for the base of Jon Snow there.
Interesting. Yeah, there is an opening there. Many openings along that wall line. And it looks like, yeah, it is a mistake because there isn't an army in the middle to take on the green player toe-to-toe.
Yeah, and Milo did just lose a lot of unnecessary Mango Dai there. And the unit control of Jon Snow is just so good. Who did just resign? Olaf did. So, yeah, he sees he can't do much there, even losing the Norse. So, but still, let's see Jon Snow. Okay, so that obviously could be the last push of Jon Snow if he's getting pushed off. But, he needs to micro-well against those onagers, and there are enough mango dice to prevent most hussars coming in. So the onager shots could be crucial, especially if you're super clumped up in the middle there. Obviously the monks are helping out, giving some extra HP to the mango dice, but this is all Milo against Jon Snow now.
Yeah, it's a very interesting play from Tetra. He basically, in poker terms, put Jon Snow all in. Jon Snow could have made more pushes after losing this army, but this army is now it for Jon Snow. He's absolutely being beaten up back at home by the Grey Player. The Grey Player now seems to have shifted his focus. He's going to send those Mangadai maybe toward the center. It is about time. Not a lot of reinforcements going to be coming in there, except for Hussars, because I think that Jon Snow took a really big hit there. And now, from multiple sides, here comes the Milo and the Tetra Hammer. Let's see if they get the job done. 37 years left, that's about 4 minutes.
Yeah, let's see. I think it's way less than 4 minutes, to be honest. And Onager shots now against Jon Snow. One good shot. Let's see a second one raining in. So many HP going down. Some Mango Dice as well. Fighting against the right hand side. Trying to regroup with the Monk, so the patrol isn't actually working. So his fights aren't good. All the Hussars coming in now are dying on the way. He's sending everything in. All the villagers, all the Mango Dice. He still has pop 150, and there's a lot of Mango Dice in the middle. But will it be enough?
Ooh, boy, it doesn't look like it's going to be enough for him to hold there. Just 26 years left, still Onager shots raining in, and they are, some of them are finding their mark, and this is a really, really bad moment. Milo, for now, is going to retreat back, which is interesting. He's going to leave it up to Tetra. Tetra doesn't actually have the army to get the job done.
I think Jon Snow might be doing it here. He is still sending some units in. He does not have anything else. He is down to basically zero villagers. Sending them all in the middle. He's sending all the stables. Let's see. It looks like Eddie is too late. And Tato will not be in time as well. This might be Jon Snow's time here to shine. Let's see. Milo is pushing him. His onager micro was pretty poor. And he only had three. I think his mass... his mass resource stacking didn't help him out. We are down to 9 years, and there are still so many Mango Dice. He can easily fight against Grey. Grey's army is still... All the relics are done for Jon Snow as well. But there are still 6 years, and there's not a real army to contest this. Only now is Eddie is coming. Eddie could easily clear all this army up, but he is just too late. And we are going down to 3 years, and this will be... Jon Snow's time. He knows everything, so the wrong name most likely.
Wow.
And he is winning King of the Hippo qualifier number 5. Congrats to Terror.
Wow, there it is. Eddie playing the part of spoiler here, really crushing and slowing down a lot of armies, but never actually going to the center himself until it was too late. And like you said, Jon Snow, he was all in. He seized the moment. He got the win.
Yeah, very nice strategic play by him there. As I said, he always kept his army over here, 110 army at the maximum, and always controlled good fights, kept the gold amount of units very low. Milo couldn't have enough siege onagers. Tetrapak couldn't even tech to siege onagers, then went for the big kill, lost all his base. As you can see, there's nothing left. He only has 60 military, and that's basically over 40 in the middle, so... He would have been totally defeated in 20 seconds, but still managed to snipe the W here.
Yeah, another great game. Came right down to the last minute. Hopefully you feel a little stamina, my friend. I feel bad for you. You've been working so hard today.
No, it's all good. I'm enjoying that. And remember, in 20 minutes, we have the next and final game for today. So, guys, stay tuned. This will be great. Let's take a look at the achievements. Obviously, Jon Snow, nice control. 150 army as a maximum. That's incredible for, Mongols. Let's take a look at the relic gold. Tetrapak. Actually, Tetrapak had the most relics. That's interesting. Getting the ones from nobody as well. Olaf with his 9 relics in the middle there. Made him get to 6k. Tito pretty poor, and Spring obviously losing his relics pretty early on. Great game, guys. So I think now nobody 41, who did not look too great in the game before. should be our the next co-caster. Killer B, thank you so much for all your hype and all your knowledge and sharing with us.
Hey, thanks for having me. This was fun. Say hi to nobody for me and enjoy the next game. I'll be watching. Enjoy.
Thanks. And did you sign up for a qualifier?
Say again?
Did you sign up for a qualifier?
I haven't signed up. No, I haven't.
Okay, there still might be some tomorrow, but obviously they might be very early for you.
Gotcha. I'll check it out. And okay, yeah, sweet. Enjoy the night, man, and keep it up. Have another shot of adrenaline and a cup of coffee or whatever it takes. We're counting on you.
Thanks. I'm doing great. Thanks for being there. Sound muted.